tailor, Sweeney Todd. His skin was pale and his eye was odd. He shaved the faces of gentlemen who never thereafter were heard of again. He trod the path that few have trod, did Sweeney Todd. The demon barber of Fleet Street.
Kept a shop in London town of fancy clients and good renown. And what if none of their songs were saved? They went to their maker impeccably shaved by Sweeney Todd, the demon barber of Fleet Street.
And a leather strop, an apron, a towel, a pail, and a mop.
For neatness he deserves a nod, the Sweeney Todd,
the demon barber of Fleet Street.
Inconspicuous Sweeney was, quick and quiet and clean he was. Back of his mud, under his word, Sweeney had music and nobody heard.
Sweeney Todd.
Attend the tale of Sweeney Todd.
He served a dark and a vengeful god.
He served a dark and a vengeful god.
What happened then? Well, that's the play, and he wouldn't want us to give it away. Not Sweeney.
Not Sweeney Todd. The demon barber of Fleet Street.
I have sailed the world, beheld its wonders, from the Dardanelles to the mountains of Peru, but there's no place like London. I feel home again. I could hear the city bells ring whatever I would do. No, there's no place like London.
Mr. Todd, sir.
You are young. Life has been kind to you. You will learn. It is here we go our several ways. Farewell, Anthony. I will not soon forget the good ship Bountiful, nor the young man who saved my life.
There's no cause to thank me for that, sir. It would have been a poor Christian indeed who'd have spotted you pitching and tossing on that raft and not given the alarm.
There's many a Christian would have done just that and not lost a wink's sleep for it either.
Off, I say! Then how would you like to split me muff, mister? We'll go jig jig, a little jig.
Off I say, to the devil with you!
Yeah.
No! Pardon me, sir, but there is no need to fear the likes of her. She's only a half-crazed beggar woman. London is full of them.
I beg your indulgence, boy. My mind is far from easy. For in these once familiar streets, I feel the chill of ghostly shadows everywhere. Forgive me.
There's nothing to forgive.
Farewell, Anthony.
Mr. Todd, before we part...
What is it?
I have honored my promise never to question you. Whatever brought you to that sorry shipwreck is your affair. And yet, during those many weeks of the voyage home, I have come to think of you as my friend. And if there is trouble for you in London, if you need help or money...
No! There's a hole in the world like a great black pit on the vermin of the world inhabit it, and its morals aren't worth what a pig could spit, and it goes by the name of London. At the top of the hole sit the privileged few, making mock of the vermin in the lower zoo, turning beauty into filth and greed. I, too, have sailed the world and seen its wonders, for the cruelty of men is as wondrous as Peru. But there's no place like London. Was a barber and his wife, and she was beautiful. A foolish barber and his wife, she was his reason and his life, and she was beautiful, and she was virtuous, and he was naive. Was another man who saw that she was beautiful, a pious vulture of the law, who with a gesture of his claw removed the barber from his plate. Then there was nothing but to wait, and she would fall, so soft, so young, so lost, and oh, so
And the lady, sir, did she succumb?
Oh, that was many years ago. I doubt if anyone would know. Now leave me, Anthony, I beg of you. There's somewhere I must go, something I must find out, now. And alone.
But surely we will meet again. Before I'm off to Plymouth.
If you want, you may well find me. Around Fleet Street, I wouldn't wonder.
Well, until then, Mr. Todd.
There's a hole in the world like a great black pit, and it's filled with people who are filled with shit, and the vermin of the world inhabit it.
A white
what you rush, what you hurry. You gave me such a fright, I thought you was a coast off. I mean, he can't just sit you down, sit. All I meant is that I haven't seen a customer for weeks. Did you come in for a pie, sir? And do forgive me if my head's a little vague. Ugh, what is that? What, you think we had the plague? From the way the people keep avoiding, no you don't. Ever knows I try, sir. Yeah. But there's no one comes in even to inhale. Right you are, sir, would you like a drop of ale? Mind you, I can hardly blame them. These are probably the worst pies in London. I know why nobody cares to take them. I should know, I'll make them. But good, no, the worst pies in London. Even that's polite, the worst pies in London. If you dare it, take a bite. Is that just disgusting? You have to concede it. It's nothing but crusting. You drink this, you'll need it. The worst pies in London. And no wonder with the price of meat what it is when you get it. Never thought I'd live to see the day men would think it was a treat finding poor animals what are dying in the street. Mrs. Mooney has a pie shop, does a business, but I noticed something weird. Lately all her neighbours' cats have disappeared. Have to hand it to her, what I calls enterprise, popping pussies into pies. I wouldn't do in my shop, just the thought of it's enough to make you sick. And I'm telling you, them pussy cats is quick. No denying times is hard, sir, even harder than the worst pies in London. Only lard and nothing more. Is that just revolting or greasy and gritty? It looks like it's molting and tastes like, well, pity a woman alone. And the worst pies in London. Oh, so times is hard. Times is hard. Spit it out, dear. Go on the floor. Worse things than that down there. Oh, that's my boy.
Isn't that a room out there, over the shop? If times are so hard, why don't you rent it out? That should bring in something.
Up there? No, I'm not going near it. People think it's haunted. You see, years ago, something happened up there. Something not very nice. There was a barber and his wife, and he was beautiful, a proper artist with a knife. But they transported him for life, and he was beautiful. Barker, his name was, Benjamin Barker.
Transported? What was his crime?
Foolishness. He had this wife, you see. Pretty little thing, silly little nit, and a chance for the moon on a string. Poor thing. There were these two, you see. One in a lot of bed, one of them a judge, the other one is Beadle. Every day they'd nudge and they'd wheedle. Still, she wouldn't budge from her needle. Too bad. Pure thing. So they merely shipped the poor bugger off, sir. They did, leaving her with nothing but grief and a year-old kid. Did she use her hair even then? Oh, no, God forbid. Poor fool. Ah, but there was worse yet to come. Poor thing. Joanna. That was the baby's name. Pretty little Joanna.
Go on.
You do like a good story, don't you? Well, Beadle calls on her all polite. Poor thing, poor thing. The judge, he tells her, is all contrite. He blames himself for her dreadful plight. She must come straight to his ass tonight. Poor thing, poor hopes when she goes there. Poor finger, poor finger. They're having this ball all in masks. There's no one she knows there. Poor dear, poor thing. She wanders tormented and drinks, poor thing. The judge has repented, she thinks, poor thing. Oh, where is Judge Turpin, she asks. He was there all right, only not so contrite. Wasn't no match for such craft, you see, and everyone thought it so droll. They figured she had to be daft, you see, so all of them stood there and laughed, you see. Poor soul, poor thing.
Will no one have mercy on her?
So it is you, Benjamin Barker.
Not Barker! Not Barker. Todd, now. Sweeney Todd. Where is she?
So changed. Good God, whatever did they do to you down there in bloody Australia or wherever?
Where's my wife? Where is Lucy?
She poisoned herself. Arsenic from the apothecary on the corner. I tried to stop her. She wouldn't listen to me.
And my daughter?
Johanna. He's got her.
He? Judge Turpin?
Well, even he had a conscience tucked away, I suppose. Adopted her like his own. Well, you could say it was good luck for her, almost.
15 years, sweating in a living hell on a trumped-up charge. 15 years! Dreaming that I might come home to a loving wife and child. Let them quake in their boots, Judge Turpin and the Beadle, for their hour has come.
What? you're going to get them, you? A bleeding little nobody of a runaway convict? Don't make me laugh, please. Woo, you'll never get his eye on Mightiness, or the Beadle neither, not in a million years. You got any money? No, listen to me. Have you got any money?
No money.
Well, how are you going to live, even?
I'll live. If I have to sweat in the sewers or in the plague hospital, I'll live. And I'll have them.
No, you poor thing, you poor thing. Wait. See?
My razors.
Yes, when they come for the little girl, I hid them. I thought, who knows, maybe the poor silly blight will be back one day and need them. I was cracked in the head, wasn't I, eh? Times as hard as they are, I could have got 5, maybe 10 quid for them any day. See? You can be a barber again. 9. Them handles is chased silver, ain't they?
Silver. Yes. These are my friends. See how they glisten. See this one shine. How he smiles in the light. My friend, my faithful friend, speak to me, friend, whisper, I listen. I know, you've been locked out of sight all these years, like me, my friend.
Rest now, my friend. Whenever you feel.
arm is complete again.
Manner mild.
He seldom laughed, but he often smiled.
He seen how civilized men behave. He never forgot and he never forgave.
Not Sweeney, not Sweeney Todd.
The demon barber of Fleet Street.
Birds today.
Hungry, as always, Miss Johanna.
Green finch and linnet bird, nightingale, blackbird, how is it you sing? How can you jubilate sitting in cages, never taking wing? Outside the sky wakes beckoning, beckoning, just beyond the bars. How can you remain staring at the rain, maddened by the stars? How is it you sing anything? How is it you sing? Green finch and linnet bird, nightingale, blackbird, how is it you sing? Whence comes this melody constantly flowing? Is it rejoicing or merely hallowing? Are you discussing or fussing or simply dreaming? Are you crowing? Are you screaming? Ring dove and robinet, is it for wages singing to be sold? Singing when you're told. My cage has many rooms, damask and dark. Nothing there sings, not even my lark. Larks never will, you know, when they're captive. Teach me to be more attentive. Oh. Teach me how to sing. If I cannot fly, let me sing.
I have sailed the world, beheld its wonders, from the pearls of Spain to the rubies of Tibet, but not even in London have I seen such a wonder. Lady, look at me, miss, oh, look at me, please, oh, favor me with your glance. Ah, miss, what do you see off there in those trees? Oh, won't you give me a chance? Who would sail to Spain for all its wonders when in Kearney's Lane lies the greatest wonder yet? Ah, miss, look at you, pale and ivory-skinned. Oh, look at you, looking so sad, so queer. Promise not to retreat to the darkness back of your window. Not till you look down here. Look at me. Look at me.
Your pardon, it's you, sir.
Mother. Perhaps you know whose house this is.
That's the great Judge Turpin's house, that is.
And the young lady that resides there?
Oh, that's Johanna, his pretty little ward. But don't you go trespassing there, young man, not if you value your hide. You tamper there, it's a good whipping for you, or any other youth with mischief on his mind. Hey, hoy, sailor boy, want it snugly harboured? Open me gate, but lock it straight, I see it list a starboard.
Here, take it. Now, off with you. Which one sings the sweetest?
All the same, sir. Sixpence and cheap at the price.
Sixpence. He sings bravely.
Oh, he does indeed, sir.
But why does he batter his wings so wildly against the bars?
We blind them, sir. Well, that's what we always does. Blind them and them not knowing night from day, they'll sing and sing without stopping. It's a pretty creature, isn't it, sir?
Yes.
Oh, have pleasure of the birds, sir.
Johanna. Johanna. I've bought this for you. Here. I feel you, Johanna. I feel you. I was half convinced I'd waken, satisfied enough to dream you. Happily, I was mistaken, Johanna.
Johanna!
I'm so sorry, Father.
If I see your face again, on this or any neighboring street, you'll rue the day that you were born. Is that plain enough speaking for you?
But, sir, I swear to you, there was no...
Dear God, I knew!
You heard his worship.
Friend, I have no fight with you.
Please, give me the bird. Pretty, pretty. Get the gist of it, friend. Next time it will be your neck.
Johanna. Future, you will stay away from your window.
Oh, Father, I hope always to be obedient to your commands.
Dear child, how sweet you look in that light muslin gown.
I feel you, yellow
Tuesdays.
Haircutter, barber, and tooth puller to His Royal Majesty, the King of Naples.
Italian, all the rage he is.
Not for long.
You really think you can do it?
By tomorrow, they'll all be flocking after me like sheep to be sure.
Now look, look, it's a Beadle Bamford.
So much the better.
Yeah, but what if he recognises you? And we better come back.
I shall do what I have set out to do, woman.
Sorry, dear, I'm sure.
May I have your attention, please? Do you wake every morning in shame and despair to discover your pillow was covered with hair? What ought not to be there? Well, ladies and gentlemen, from now on you can waken at ease. You need never again ever worry or care. I will show you a miracle marvellous rare. Gentlemen, you are about to see something what rose from the dead. On the top of my head. Scarcely a month ago, gentlemen, I was suddenly struck with a rare oriental disease. That the finest physicians in London were called. I awakened one morning amazed and appalled to discover with dread that my head was as bald as a novice's knees. I was dying of shame till a gentleman came, an illustrious barber, Pirelli by name. It gave me a liquid as precious as gold. I rubbed it in day like what I was told. And behold, less than 30 days old. T'was Pirelli's miracle elixir. This what did the trick, sir. Throw, sir, throw. Was it quick, sir? Did it in a tick, sir? Just like an elixir or to do. How about a bottle, mister? And it costs a penny guarantee.
Penny buys a bottle, I don't know.
You don't need.
Oh, mister.
Does Pirelli stimulate the growth, sir? You can have my oath, sir. Tis unique. Rub a minute, stimulating in it. Soon you'll have to fin it once awake. Penny buys a bottle, guarantee.
Penny buys a bottle,
how about a sample? Have you ever smelled a cleaner smell?
That's enough to ramble.
Gently dab it, gets to be a habit. Soon there'll be enough, sir, somebody can grab it. See that chap with hair like Shelley's. You can tell he's used Pirelli's.
Pardon me, man,
go
what's that feel,
mum? Miracle elixir, anything was slick, sir. So sprouts curls, try Pirelli's when they see our fixer. You can have your picture of the girls. Wanna buy a bottle, missus?
What is this?
Penny for a bottle.
Smells like piss.
Have you ever smelled the cleaner smell?
How about sample,
mister? Activate your roots, sir.
Keep it off your boots, sir. Eats right.
Don't you get it?
Get Pirelli's. Use a bottle of it. Ladies seem to love it.
Flies do too.
Pirelli's miracle elixir, grow a little wixer, then some fuzz. Then Pirelli's gonna make a fixer, love an elixir, always does. Trust Pirelli's, then you have a sixer, fix it in an elixir, don't know when. Just Pirelli's miracle elixir, then it's a trick, sir. If you're gonna kick, sir.
Don't get Pirelli,
tell it to the mixer, the miracle elixir, if you're gonna kick, sir.
Adolfo Pirelli, the king of the barbers, the barber of kings, e buongiorno.
good day. I blow you a kiss. So famous Pirelli, I wish you to know her, who has it never to say. My elixir is a piss. Who say this?
I do. I am Mr. Sweeney Todd. I have opened a bottle of Pirelli's miracle elixir, and I say to you, it is nothing but an arrant fool.
Ladies and gentlemen, pay no attention to this madman. Who's to be the first for a magnificent shave?
And furthermore, I have serviced no kings, yet I wager that I can shave a cheek and pull a tooth with 10 times more dexterity than any street mountebank. You see these razors?
The finest in England.
I lay them against £5 that you are no match for me. Do you hear me, sir? Either accept my challenge or reveal yourself as a sham.
Bravo, bravo!
These are indeed fine risers. Instruments like these, once seen, cannot be soon forgotten. Tell me, you wedge these against £5?
I do.
You hear this foolish man? Watch and see how he will regret his folly. £5 it is.
Friends, neighbours, who's for the free shave?
Who will it?
Bring me a chair.
You, boy, go with him and good luck. You, bring the basins, bring us a towel.
Yes, sir.
Quick.
Will Beadle Bamford be the judge?
Glad as always to oblige my friends and neighbours. Ready?
Ready!
Ready?
The fastest, smoothest shave is the winner.
Now, signorini, signori, we mix it a lather, but first you gather around. Signorini, signori, you looking a man who have had the glory to shave for the Pope, Mr. Sweeney, whoever, I'm begging your pardon, I'll probably say it was only a cardinal. Nope! It was the Pope! To shave the face, to pull the tooth, required a grace and not a brute. For if you slip, you nick the skin, you clip the chin, you rip the lip a bit, and that's the truth. To shave the face, or even a part, we doubt it a smart, require the heart, it take the art. I show you a chart. I study a starting in my youth. The bambino. To cut the hair, to trim the beard. To make a da bristle clean like a whistle. This is from early infancy, the talent give to me by God. It take the skill, it take the brains, it take the will to take the pains, it take the pace, it take the grace.
Excuse me! Shut up!
What?
The winner is Todd.
Sir, I bow to a skill far defter than my own.
The £5.
Here, Mr. Todd, there. And may the good Lord smile on you until we meet again. Come, boy, signor. Bellissima signorina, buongiorno, eh? Buongiorno a tutti, eh?
Feel this smooth as a baby's
Oh, who'd have thought it, dear? You pulled it off.
So, sir, Mr. Todd, sir, do you have an establishment of your own?
He certainly does. Sweeney Tots Tots Sorial Parlour. Above my meat pie shop down Fleet Street.
Mr. Todd. Strange, sir, but it seems your face is known to me.
Oh, well, him! Him now, him being my uncle's cousin what arrived from Birmingham yesterday.
But already, sir, I've heard Beadle Bamford spoken of with great respect.
Well, sir, I try my best for my neighbours. Fleet Street, over your pie shop, ma'am.
That's right, sir.
Then, Mr. Todd, you will surely see me there before the week is out.
You will be welcome, Beadle Bamford. And I guarantee to give you, without a penny's charge, the closest shave you will ever know.
Sweeney pondered and Sweeney planned, like a perfect machine he planned.
Bobbing the hook,
baiting the trap,
searching it out for the beetle to snap.
Slyly caught it and Sweeney did,
set a storm in the sea.
Laying the trail, showing the traces, letting it lead to higher places.
Sweeney pondered and Sweeney planned, like a perfect machine he planned.
Mea culpa, mea culpa, mea maxima culpa, mea maxima, maxima culpa. God deliver me, release me, forgive me, restrain me, avenge me. Johanna, Johanna, so suddenly a woman, the light behind your window, it penetrates your gown. Johanna, Johanna, the sun, I see the sun through your... No! God! Deliver me! Deliver me! Down, down, down. Johanna, Johanna, I watch you from the shadows. You sigh before your window and gaze upon the town. Your lips part, Johanna, so young and soft and beautiful. Ah, deliver me! Help! Leave me, Johanna, Johanna. I treasured you in innocence and loved you like a daughter. Mock me, Johanna. You tempt me with your innocence. You tempt me with those quivering. No, God, deliver me. It will stop. Now it will stop. Right now. Right now. Right now. Johanna, I cannot keep you longer. The world is at your window. You want to fly away. You stir me, Johanna. So suddenly a woman. I cannot watch you one more day. God, deliver me. God, deliver me. God, deliver God. Johanna, Johanna, I'll keep you here forever. I'll wait you on the morrow. Johanna, Johanna, the world will never touch you. I'll wait you on the morrow. As years pass, Johanna, you tend me in my solitude. No longer as a daughter, as a woman,
Johanna, Johanna, I'll hold you here forever then. You'll keep away from windows and you'll deliver me, Johanna, from this hot red devil with your soft, white, cool, virgin palms.
Father.
Joanna, I trust you've not been near the window again.
Hardly, dear father, when it has been shuttered and barred these last 3 days.
How right I was to insist on such a precaution. For once again he has come, that conscienceless young sailor. 10 times has he been driven from my door. Oh, if I were to think...
Think what, dear father?
If I were to think you encouraged this young rogue.
I, a maid. Trained from the cradle to find in modesty and obedience the greatest of all virtues. Dear father, when have you ceased to warn me of the wickedness of men?
Venal young men of the street, with but one thought in their heads. But there are men of a different and far higher breed. I have one in mind for you.
You have?
A gentleman who will shield you from all earthly cares. And guide your faltering steps to the sober warmth of womanhood. A husband, a protector, but yet an ardent lover, too. It is a man who, through all the years, has surely earned your affection.
You!
Many times have I told you I will not have trash from the gutter hanging round my establishment.
Not just a penny, dear. Or a pie. One of them pies that gives the shits to half the neighbourhood.
Oh,
come on, dear. Have a heart, dear.
Oh, I tell you, when I give you a kick up the arse, it'll make your teeth rattle.
Oh, you and your fancy airs. Arms, arms, for a desperate woman.
Did you hear me? Get yourself off. Go on, get yourself down the street. Bobbiting moonies, that's it, yes. Put your snout down her fins. Oh, God, I'm coming to jig about. This chair. Now, no, it's not much of a one, but it'll do till you get your fancy new one. Oh, it was me poor Albert's chair, it was. Sat in it all day long, he did, after his leg give out from the dropsy. Oof, kind of bare, isn't it? Never did like a bare room still. Never mind, we'll soon get a few little knick-knacks.
Why doesn't the Beadle come? Before the week is out, that's what he said.
Well, who says the week's out yet? It's only Friday. Easy now. Hush, love, hush. Don't distress yourself. Watch your rush. Keep your faults nice and lush. Wait. Hush, love, hush. Think it through. Once it bubbles, then what's to do? Wait. I've been thinking flowers, maybe daisies, to brighten up the room. Don't you think some flowers, pretty daisies, might relieve the gloom? Oh, wait, love, wait.
And the judge, where will I get him?
You think of nothing else. You're always brooding away on your wrongs. What happened ever knows how many years ago. Slow, love, slow. Time's so fast. Now goes quickly, see. Now it's past. Soon will come. Soon will last.
white. Don't you know, silly men, half the fun is to plan the plan. All good things come to them what can wait. Gillyflowers maybe, instead of daisies. I don't know though. What do you think?
Yes.
Yes. Gillyflowers, I'd say. Nothing like a nice bowl of gillies.
Ah! Anthony.
Mr. Todd, I've paced Fleet Street a dozen times with no success, but now the barber's sign. In business already.
Yes, yes.
Well, I congratulate you. Oh, and,
Mrs. Lovett, sir. Mrs. Lovett.
It's a pleasure, ma'am.
Oh.
Mr. Todd, I have so much to tell you. I have found the fairest and most loving maid that any man could dream of. Well, and yet there are problems. Well, she has a guardian so tyrannical that she is kept shut up from human eye.
Oh, God.
But now, this morning, this key fell from her shuttered window. The surest sign that Johanna loves me. Now,
Johanna?
Well, that's her name, ma'am. And Turpin, that of the abominable parent. A judge, it seems. But as I said, a monstrous tyrant. Mr. Todd, once the judge has gone to court, I'll slip into the house and plead with her to fly with me tonight. Yet, when I have her, where can I bring her till I have hired a coach to speed us home to Plymouth? Mr. Todd, if I could lodge her here, just for a few hours or so...
Oh, bring her, dear, bring her!
Oh, thank you, ma'am. And I have your consent, Mr. Todd.
The girl may come.
I shall be grateful for this... to the grave. Oh, now I must hurry, for surely the judge is off to the Old Bailey, so I'd better... Oh, look, my thanks, and 1,000 blessings on you both.
Oh, no, no. Oh, Johanna, who'd have thought it? It's like fate, and it... You'll have her back before the day is out.
For a few hours, until he carries her off to the other end of England.
What, that sailor? No... Let him bring her here, and then, since you're so hot for a bit of... That's the throat to slit, dear. Oh. Oh, Mr. T. We'll make such a lovely home for her. You and me, eh? All them years without a scrap of motherly affection. Well, I'll soon change that, I will, because if ever there was a maternal heart, it's mine. Oh, who's that coming up the stairs?
Good morning, Mr. Todd. And to you, bellissima signorina.
Well, how do you do, signor, I'm sure.
A little business with Mr. Todd, signora. Perhaps if you will give the permission.
Oh, yes, yes, indeed, yes. I'll just pop on down to my pies then, shall I? Oh, Lorks, look at it now. Looks like it ain't had a kind word since our past never. What's your name, son?
Toby.
Oh, well then, Toby. How'd you like a nice juicy meat pie, eh? Your teeth is strong, I hope.
Oh, yes, ma'am.
Well, come with me then, love.
Mr. Todd.
Signor Pirelli.
You can call me Donnie. Daniel O'Higgins, the name when it's not professional league. Hey, there. I'd like my 5 quid back, if you don't mind.
Why?
Well, it'll hold me over till your customers start coming. And then it's half your profits you'll hand over to me. Every week, on a Friday. Well, share and share alike, eh? Will that be all right, Mr. Benjamin Barker?
Why do you call me that?
You don't remember me, eh? Why should you? I was just a down-and-out Irish lad you had for the couple of weeks, eh? Sweeping up her and such like. But you know, I remember these raises, and I remember you. Benjamin Barker, later transported to Botany Bay for life. Am I right? So, Mr. Todd, is it a deal, eh? Or do I run down the street for me pal Beadle Bamford, huh?
You think you were smart? Are you foolish, a boy? Tomorrow you start in my employ. You understand? Huh? You like my plan?
Oh, God, he's got an appointment with his tailor. If he's late and it's my fault, well, you don't know him.
Oh, no. Well, I wouldn't go up there if I was you, dear.
Signor Slate, the tailor. Ah, my wig.
Where can I hide him? In this chest.
Signor, I did like you said. I reminded you, the tailor. Ah. He ain't here.
Signor Pirelli has been called away.
Well, where'd he go?
He didn't say. You'd better run after him.
Oh, no, knowing him so well, without orders to the contrary, I'll best wait for him here.
So, Mrs. Lovett gave you a pie, did she, lad?
Yeah, she's a real kind lady, one whole pie.
A whole pie? Well, that's a treat. Yet if I know a young boy, there's still room for more, eh?
Oh, I'd say, sir, an aching void.
Well, then why don't you run downstairs and wait for your master there, eh? There'll be another pie in it for you, I'm sure.
Thank you, sir.
Tell Mrs. Lovett to give you a nice big tot of gin.
Gin, sir? Oh, thanking you kindly. Gin. Oh, Mr. Todd!
Yes.
Well, you're a Christian indeed, sir. Mom, what a gentleman says to give you a nice big tot of gin.
Gin, dear? Oh, wow. Oh, why not? Come on, then. Let's go into my lovely back parlour, eh? There now. See how nice and comfy cosy it is?
No! No!
His hands were quick, his fingers strong. It stung a little, but not for long. And those who thought him a simple clod were soon reconsidering under the sod.
Consigned there with a friendly prod from Sweeney Todd, the demon barber of Fleet Street.
See your razor gleam, Sweeney. Feel how well it fits. How well it fits as it floats across the throats of hypocrites.
This is the fourth time, sir, that you've been brought before this bench. Though it is my earnest wish ever to temper justice with mercy, your persistent dedication to a life of crime is such an abomination before God and man that I have no alternative. The sentence of the law which I have to pronounce upon you is that you be taken to the place from whence you came, from thence that you be taken to a place of execution, and that you be hanged by the neck until you be dead, and that your body be taken down and given to the surgeons for dissection. And may God of his infinite mercy have compassion on your soul. Court adjourned. It is perhaps remiss of me to close the court so early, but the stench of those miserable wretches at the bar was so offensive to my nostrils, I feared my eagerness for fresher air might well impair the soundness of my judgment.
Well, sir, the adjournment is fortunate for me, sir, for it is today we celebrate my sweet little Annie's birthday, and to have her daddy back so soon to hug and kiss her will be her crowning joy on such a happy day.
It is a happy moment for me, too. Walk home with me, for I have news for you. In order to shield her from the evils of this world, I have decided to marry Johanna next Monday.
Happy news indeed, sir.
Strange, but when I offered myself to her, she showed a certain reluctance. But that's natural enough in a young girl. Now that she's had time for reflection, I'm sure she will greet my proposal in a more sensible frame of mind.
Oh, dear, was that a noise? A I think I heard a noise. A couldn't be. He's caught. Stay still. There was a noise. Wasn't that a noise? He must have heard it.
Kiss me.
Oh, sir.
Promise.
Oh, sir. If he should marry me Monday, what will I do? I'll die of
fright. Fly tonight.
Tis Friday, virtually Sunday. What can we do with time so brief?
Fly tonight.
Behind the curtain, quick.
Tonight.
I think I heard a click.
Tonight.
It was a gate. It's a gate. We don't have a gate. Still, there was a wait. There's another click. You must have heard it.
Kiss me.
Tonight.
Kiss me.
You'll be tonight.
Marry on Monday, that's what you'll do.
I'm glad, sir. I knew I'd be with you one day, even not knowing who you were.
Miss, marry me Monday.
Favour
me,
favour me with your hand. Miss, marry me, good to see again, and raise you by the kiss me.
Of course.
Quickly.
You're sure.
Kiss me.
I shall.
Kiss me. Oh, sir.
Yes, yes, but surely the respect she owes me as her guardian should be sufficient to kindle a more tender emotion.
Excuse me, my lord. May I request my lord permission, my lord, to speak? Forgive me if I suggest, my lord, you're looking less than your best, my lord. There's powder upon your vest, my lord, and stubble upon your cheek. And ladies, my lord, are we?
Perhaps if she greets me cordially upon my return, I should give her a small gift.
Ladies in the sensitivities, my lord, have a fragile sensibility. When a girl's emergent, probably it's urgent. You defer to her gentility, my lord. Personal disorder cannot be ignored, given their genteel proclivities. Meaning no offense, it happens they resent it. Ladies in their sense.
Stubble, you say. Perhaps at times I'm a little over hasty in my morning ablutions.
Fret not, though, my lord. I know a place, my lord, a barber, my lord, of skill. Thus armed with a shaven face, my lord, some eau de cologne to brace, my lord, and musk to enhance the chase, my lord. You'll dazzle the girl until she bows to your every.
That may well be so.
Here we are, sir, at your house. I bid you good day.
Good day. And where is this miraculous barber?
In Fleet Street, sir.
Perhaps you may be right. Take me to him.
Name is Todd.
We must not wait till Monday.
Currently
it isn't right. We must be married on Sunday.
Saturday, sir, would also do. I think I heard a noise.
What?
I mean another noise. Oh, never mind, just a noise. Just another noise. Something in the street. Down the silly little thing. You know, kiss me. Oh, sir.
We'll go to Paris on Monday.
What shall I wear? I daren't pack.
Ride a train.
With you beside me on Sunday. What do I care what things I lack? I need my reticule. Mustn't think me a fool, but my reticule never leaves my side. It's the only thing my mother gave me. Kiss me.
The name is
Kiss me.
Anthony.
Todd.
Todd.
Anthony.
Todd.
I'll marry Anthony someday. That's what I'll do, no matter what. Have a grand tendency. Only afraid that you just got to say. I think I'll come back to some way. I'll give you kill and play. Just don't tell if I want to see. Get written by the sympathy. Oh, sir.
Oh, miss.
Oh, sir.
Oh, miss.
Oh, sir.
Oh, miss.
Oh, now, Toby, dear, maybe you should be running along.
Oh, no, I didn't budge till he calls for me.
Oh, well, I'll pop upstairs. I'll see what Mr. Todd says, eh? Oh, God. Oh, maybe poor old knees ain't what they was, dear. Oh, how long before the Italian gets back, then?
He won't be back.
Oh, you didn't. Oh, Mr. T. Oh, you're crazy mad killing a man. What done you no harm?
He recognised me from the old days. He tried to blackmail me. Half my earnings forever.
Well, that is a different matter. Oh, what a relief, dear. For a minute there, I thought you'd gone and lost your marbles, you know. Oh, that blood. Oh, it's enough to make you come over all goose flesh, isn't it? Eh? Oh, well, never mind. Eh? Oh, poor bugger. Oh, he's got ever such a pretty purse. I think I'll have it. £3. Well, waste not, want not. That's what I always say.
There you are, sir. Above the pie shop.
I see. You may leave me now.
Yes, sir. Thank you. Thank you, sir.
Ooh! First, there's the boy downstairs.
Send him up here.
Oh, no. Surely one's enough for today, dear. You shouldn't indulge yourself, you know.
Providence is kind.
Who is it?
Judge Turpin.
Judge him? Him, it can't be.
Quick, leave me.
What are you going to do?
Leave me, I said.
Oh, don't worry, dear. I'm out. Oh, do excuse me, your lordship.
Mr. Todd.
At your service, sir. An honour to receive your patronage, sir.
These premises are hardly prepossessing. Yet the Beadle tells me you are the most accomplished of all the barbers in the city.
Oh, that is gracious of him, sir. And you must please excuse the modesty of my establishment. It is only a few days ago that I set up quarters here, and some necessaries are yet to come. Sit, sir. If you please, sir, sit. And what may I do for you, sir? A stylish trimming of the hair? A soothing skin massage?
You see, sir, a man infatuate with love, her ardent and eager slave. So fetch the pomade and pumice stone and lend me a more seductive tone, a sprinkling perhaps of French cologne. But first, sir, I think, a shave.
The closest I ever gave.
You're in a merry mood today, Mr. Todd.
Tis your delights are catching fire from one man to the next.
Tis true, sir, love can still inspire the bloods to pound, the heart leap higher,
What more?
What more can men require
than love, sir?
More than love, sir.
What, sir?
Women.
Ah, yes, women.
Pretty women.
My lord.
And who, may it be said, is your intended, sir?
My ward, and pretty as a rosebud.
As pretty as another!
What was that?
Nothing, sir. Nothing. May we proceed? Pretty women. Fascinating. Sipping coffee. Dancing, pretty women are a wonder. Pretty women sitting in the window or standing on the stair. Something in them cheers the silhouetted, stay within you. Glances, stay forever.
Breathing lightly.
Pretty women, pretty women. Blowing out their candles. Or combing out their hair.
Somehow can still remember
there. You are pretty women at the
beach. In their gardens,
that's a writing.
Flower picking,
where they're watching how they make a man sing. Proof of heaven as you're living. Pretty women, sir, pretty women. Yes, sir, pretty women.
Tonight, we'll be in Paris by Monday, out of that heartless tyrant's sight.
Judge Turpin.
There is indeed a higher power to warn me thus in time. Johanna, elope with you?
Deceitful slut!
I'll lock her up in some obscure retreat, where neither you nor any other vile, corrupting youth shall ever lay eyes on her again.
But, sir, I...
And as for you, barber, 'tis all too clear what company you keep. Service them well and hold their custom, for you'll have none of mine.
Mr. Todd, I just...
Out.
No, I simply
out
came up...
Out, I say!
He's running and shouting. What is it now, dear?
I had him.
Yes, and yes, then... I saw the sailor busted in. I saw them both running down the street. I said to myself, the fence in a bar.
I had him. His throat was bare beneath my hand.
Dear, dear, don't fret, dear.
No, I had him. His throat was there, and he'll never come again.
Easy now, hush, love, hush. I keep telling you.
When?
What's your rush?
Why did I wait? You told me to wait. Now he'll never come again. There's a hole in the world like a great black pit, and it's filled with people who are filled with shit, and the vermin of the world inhabit it. But not for long. They all deserve to die. Tell you why, Mrs. Lovett, tell you why. Because
in all of the whole human race, Mrs. Lovett. There are two kinds of men and only two. There's the one staying put in his proper place, and the one with his foot in the other one's face. Look at me, Mrs. Lovett, look at you. No, we all deserve to die. Even you, Mrs. Lovett, even I. Because the lives of the wicked should be made free. For the rest of us, death will be a relief. We all deserve to die. And I'll never see Johanna. No, I'll never hug my girl to me.
Finish!
All right. You, sir, how about a shave? Come and visit your good friend, Sweeney. You, sir, too, sir, welcome to the grave. I will have vengeance. I will have salvation. Oh, sir, you, sir, no one in the chair. Come on, come on. Sweeney's waiting. I want you bleeders. You, sir, anybody, a gentleman, don't be shy. Not one man, nor 10 men, nor 100 can assuage me. I will have you. And I will get him back, even as he gloats. In the meantime, I practice on less honorable throats. And my Lucy lies in ashes. And I'll never see my girl again. But the work waits. I'm alive at last. And I'm full of joy.
That's all very well. Listen to me. Can you hear me? Can you hear me? Now listen. Pull yourself together. What are we going to do with the Italian, eh? And there's the boy in the back parlour. No! Now listen. That boy, he's as simple as a baby lamb, and I can fob him off with some story. Easy. But him upstairs. What are we going to do with him, eh?
Later on, when it's dark, we'll take him to some secret place and bury him.
Yes. Yes. Well, we could do that. I don't suppose there's any relatives going to come poking around looking for him.
Well, you know me. Ideas. Just pop into my head. Oh, I was thinking, seems a downright shame.
Shame?
Seems an awful waste. Such a nice plump frame. And what's his name as? Ad. As. And nor it can't be traced. Business needs a lift. It's to be erased. I'll think of it as thrift, as a gift. If you get my drift. Now, seems an awful waste. I mean, with the price of meat, what it is, when you get it, if you get it.
Ah!
Good, you got it. Take, for instance, Mrs. Mooney and her pie shop. Business never better, using only pussycats and toast. Now, pussy's good for maybe 6 or 7 at the most. And I'm sure they can't compare as far as taste.
Mrs. Lovett, what a charming notion, well, eminently practical and yet appropriate as always. Mrs. Lovett, how I did without you all these years, I never know.
Think about it. Lots of other gentlemen are soon becoming quite
shy. Also undetectable. How choice.
All them pies.
Oh, what's
the sound of the world out there.
What, Mr. Toad, what, Mr. Toad, what is that sound?
Those crunching noises pervading the air.
Yes, Mr. Toad, yes, Mr. Toad, yes, all around.
It's man devouring man, my dear.
And who are we to deny it in here?
Oh, these are desperate times, Mrs. Lovett, and desperate measures are called for.
Oh, yes. Here we are, hot from the oven.
What is that?
It's priest. Have a little priest.
Is it really good?
Sir, it's too good, at least. Then again, they don't commit sins of the flesh, so it's pretty fresh.
Awful lot of fat.
Only where it's sat.
Haven't you got poet or something like that?
No, you see, the trouble with poet is how do you know it's deceased? Try the priest.
Heavenly. Not as hearty as bishop, perhaps, but not as bland as curate,
no,
either.
And good for business, always leaves you wanting more. Trouble is, we only get it on Sundays. Lawyer's rather nice.
If it's for a price.
Order something else, though, to follow, since no one should swallow it twice.
Anything that's lean.
Well, sir, if you're British and loyal, you might enjoy Royal Marine. Anyway, it's clean. Now, of course, it tastes of wherever it's been.
Is that squire on the fire?
Now, sir, look closer, you'll notice it's grosser.
It looks thicker, more like vicar.
No, it has to be grosser, it's green.
The history of the world, my love.
Save a lot of graves, do a lot of relatives favours.
Is those below serving those up above?
Everybody shaves, so there should be plenty of flavours.
How gratifying for once to know
that those above will serve those down below.
Here, all right, then, we got Tinker.
Something pinker.
Taylor.
Something paler.
Potter.
Something hotter.
Butler.
Something subtler.
Locksmith. Lovely bit of clock.
Maybe for a lark.
Then again, it's sweet if you want it cheap and you like it dark. Try the financier, peak of his career.
That looks pretty rank.
Well, he drank. It's a bank cashier. Last one ever sold. Maybe it was old.
Have you any Beadle?
Next week, so I'm told. A Beadle isn't bad till you smell it and notice how well it's been greased. Stick to priest. No, you're this one might be just a little bit stringy, but then again, it's fiddle player.
Oh, this isn't fiddle player, this is piccolo player.
How can you tell?
Because it's piping hot.
Then blow on it first.
The history of the world, my sweet.
Oh, Mr. Todd, what does it tell?
Is who gets eaten and who gets to eat.
And Mr. Todd too, Mr. Todd, who gets to sell.
But fortunately it's all so clear.
But everybody goes down well with beer.
Since Marine doesn't appeal to you, how about to Rear Admiral?
No, too salty. I prefer General.
With or without his private. With his extra.
What is that?
It's fop. Finest in the shop. Oh, we have some shepherd's pie peppered with actual shepherd on top. And I've just begun. Here's the politician, so oily. It's served with a doily, not one.
Put it on a bun. Well, you never know if it's going to run.
Try the fryer, fried it's drier.
No, the clergy is really too coarse and too mealy.
An actor, that's compactor.
Yes, Christmas and always arrives over, darling. I'll come again when you have Judge on the menu.
Wait, wait. True, we don't have Judge yet. But we got something you might find even better.
And what is that?
Executioner!
Have charity towards the world, my pet.
Yes, yes, I know, my love.
We'll take the customers that we can get.
I born and low, my love.
We'll not discriminate great from small. No, we'll serve anyone, beneath anyone, and to anyone at all.
Have your attention, please. Are your nostrils a-quivering, tingling as well at that delicate, luscious, ambrosial smell? Yes, they are, I can tell. Well, ladies and gentlemen, that aroma enriching the braise is like nothing compared to its succulent sauces the gourmets among you will tell you, of course. Ladies and gentlemen, you can't imagine the rapture in store just inside of this door. Sample Mrs. Lovett's meat pies, savoury and sweet pies, as you'll see. You who eat pies, Mrs. Lovett's meat pies, conjure up the treat pies used to be.
Over here, boy, how about some ale?
Let me have a favour,
right away.
We have some service, like the hem on the back.
Trumpets, ladies and gentlemen.
Your dearie, how have you been keeping? Call me Bones is weary, Toby. One for the gentleman here, the bird is cheeping. Helps to keep it cheery, Toby. Throw the old woman out. What's your pleasure, dearie? No, we don't cut slices. Call me eyes is bleary, Toby. None for the gentleman, I could up me prices. I'm a little leery, business couldn't be better though. Knock on wood. Excuse me. Dear, see to the customers. Yes, what? Laugh quick, though the trade is brisk.
But it's 6 o'clock.
So it's 6 o'clock.
It was due to arrive at 4:45,
and
it's
6 o'clock.
It's probably
already down the block. It'll be.
It'll be here by now. Come back when it comes.
Because my customers truly are getting out really. What's your pleasure, dearie? Oops, I beg your pardon. Just me hands is smeary. Toby, run for the gentleman. Don't you love a garden? Always makes me teary. Must be one of them foreigners. Dear, forgive my candour. Family secret, all to do with herbs. Things like being careful with your coriander. That's what makes the gravy grander.
More hot pies, more hot, more pies.
Psst, excuse me. Psst, dear, say to the customers. Psst, yes, what love, quick though the trade is brisk.
But it's here, it's where? Coming up the stair.
I'll get rid of this lot as they're still pretty hot.
It's about
I'll
to be
there.
Over, don't you care?
I'll be there,
but we have to be there.
If I let him get cold, and incidentally, dearie, you know Mrs. Mooney, sales have been so dreary. Toby, poor thing is penniless. What about that loony? Looking sort of beery. Oh, well, gotta come up and say, that'll be threepence. And
oh, that's so shut, she's deep. How you been just ever tasted? Smell such, oh my God, what more? That's pies good.
That a chair fit for a king, a wondrous
neat
and most particular chair. You tell me, where is there a seat can half compare with this particular thing? I have a few minor adjustments to make. They'll take
you take your time, I'll go sit to the customers.
I have another friend.
Todd.
Is that a pie fit for a king? A one
right
and mouse
particular.
You say, Mom, why there is no meat pie? Think of pear with this delectable pie. The crust of velvety and wavy that lies those crimps.
Now to test this best of Barber chest. It's time
to move
this time.
Excuse me.
Psst.
Dear, say to the customers,
psst.
All set, love.
Quick now.
My heart's a flutter.
When I pound the floor.
When you pound the floor.
It's a signal to show that I'm ready to go. When I pound the floor.
When you pound the floor. Will you trust me?
I just want to be sure.
I've been waiting below.
But I'm certain that you're in place. I'll pound three times. Three times. And then you, three times, if you, exactly.
Four hot pies, four hot
fries,
four pies,
wait!
I feel you, Johanna. I feel you. Do they think that walls can hide you? Even now I'm at your window. I am in the dark. Beside you, buried sweetly in your yellow hair, Johanna.
A shave, sir? Sit, sir. Sit.
And are you beautiful and pale with yellow hair like her? I'd want you beautiful and pale the way I've dreamed you were. Johanna. And if you're beautiful, what then with yellow hair like wheat? I think we shall not meet again, my little dark, my sweet. Goodbye, Johanna. You're gone, and yet you're mine. I'm fine, Johanna.
Fire, witch, witch, smell it, sir, an evil smell. Every
night of the Vesper spell. Smoke that comes from the mouth of hell. City on fire! City on fire!
Sit, sir. Sit. And if I never hear your voice, my turtle dove, my dear, I still have reason to rejoice. The way ahead is clear. That darkness when I'm blind with what I can't forget. It's always morning in my mind, my little lamb, my pet, Joanna. You stay, Joanna, the way I've dreamed you are. Oh, look, Joanna. A star, a shooting star.
There, there, somebody, somebody, look up there. Didn't I tell you, smell that air? City on fire.
Shave, sir? Sit, sir. Sit. And though I'll think of you, oh yes, until the day I die, I think I miss you less and less as every day goes by. Beautiful and pale and look too much like her. If only angels could prevail, we'd be the way we were. Joanna, wake up, Joanna, another bright red day. We learn, Joanna.
Please tell me, what house is this?
That's Mr. Fogg's private asylum for the mentally deranged.
A madhouse?
I'd keep away from there if I was you.
A madhouse? Joanna? Joanna! Open! Open the door!
What's all this hollering and shouting?
Sir, there has been a monstrous perversion of justice. A young woman, as sane as you or I, has been incarcerated here.
Is that a fact? And now what is this young person's name?
Joanna.
Joanna! That wouldn't by any chance be Judge Turpin's ward.
He's the one. He's the devil incarnate that has done this to her.
Oh, watch your tongue. That girl's as mad as the seven seas. I brought her here myself. So, Hobbit.
You have no right.
No right. You just Hobbit, or I'm booking you for disturbing the peace.
But I haven't done
it. Assailing an officer.
Joanna! Joanna! Joanna!
After him! Get him! Break his arms if need be! That's the sort of scallywag that gets this neighborhood into disrepute.
Come on in. Oh, nothing like a nice sit down, is there, dear? After a hard day's work. Mm. Oh, yes. Now then, let me see. Now that is 3 and 11 pence that makes. We didn't carry one. Oh! Oh! £4.14 for the week. Oh, it's not bad. And that don't include what I had to pay out for my nice cheery wallpaper. Oh, or the harmonium. Oh, a real bargain it was too, dear. It being only partly singed when the chapel burnt down. Mr. T, you listening to me?
Of course.
Yes, what I say then, eh?
There must be a way to the judge.
Oh, that bloody judge! You are always harping on that bloody judge. Oh, look, we got a nice respectable business now. Money coming in regular, and since we're careful to pick and choose, only strangers and such like what won't be missed. Who's going to catch on, eh? Oh, Mr. Todd, I'm so happy. I could eat you up, I really could. You know what I'd like to do, Mr. Todd? What a dream. If the business stays as good, where I'd really like to go in a year or so. Don't you want to know?
Of course.
Do you really want to know?
Yes, yes, I do, I do. Do.
Well, see, I've always had this dream ever since I was a skinny little slip of a thing. And my rich Aunt Nettie used to take me to the seaside August bank holiday. Oh, the pier, digging little castles in the sand. I'm still feeling my toes wiggling round in the briny. And by the sea, Mr. Todd, that's the life I carve it by the sea, Mr. Todd. Oh, I know you'd love it, you and me, Mr. T. We could be alone in a house what we'd almost own. Down by the sea, wouldn't that be smashing? With the sea at our gate, we'd have kippered airing. What have swum to a strait from the Straits of Bering? Every night in the kip, when we're through our kippers, I'll be there slipping off your slippers by the sea, where the fish is splashing. By the sea, wouldn't that be smashing? Down by the sea.
Anything you say, anything you say.
I can see us waking, the breakers breaking, the seagull squawking. Ee-ee. I do me baking, then I go walking with you. You. I warm me bones on the esplanade, have tea and scones with me gay young blade. Then I'll knit a sweater while you write a letter, unless we got better to do.
Anything you say.
think how snug it'll be underneath our flannel when it's just you and me and the English Channel in our cosy retreat, kept all neat and tidy. We'll have chums over every Friday by the sea.
Anything you say.
Don't you love the weather? By the sea, we'll grow old together. Down by the seaside, by the beautiful sea. Oh, I can see us now in our bathing dresses. You in a nice rich navy, and me stripes, perhaps. It'll be so quiet that all come by it except a seagull. We shouldn't try it though, till it's legal for two. But a seaside wedding could be devised. Me rumpled bedding legitimised. Me eyelids will flutter, I turn into butter the moment I mutter I do. By the sea in our nest, we could share our kippers with the odd paying guest from the weekend trippers. Have a nice sunny suite for the guest to rest in. Now and then you could do the guesting by the sea. Married nice and proper by the sea. Bring along your chopper to the seaside. Ooh-ooh. Oh, come on, dear. Give us a kiss. Oh, that was lovely. Now, Mr. T, you do love me just a little bit, don't you?
Of course.
Oh, yeah. Well, how about it then, eh? Of course, it'd have to be a little trip to St. Swithin's first, just to legalise things, but that won't be too painful, would it?
I'll make them pay for what they did to Lucy.
Now, you listen to me, dear. It's high time you forgot them morbid fancies. Your Lucy's gone, poor thing. It's your Nelly now. Oh, here. Let's have a nice bonbon. You know, 17 years this Whitson since my poor Albert passed on. I don't see why we shouldn't be married in white, do you?
Mr. Todd, I found her.
You found Johanna?
That monster of a judge has had her locked away in a madhouse.
Where?
Where no one can reach her. At Mr. Fogg's asylum. Oh, Mr. Todd, she's in there with those screeching, gibbering maniacs.
A madhouse. A madhouse! Johanna is as good as rescued.
She is?
Where do you suppose all the wig makers of London go to obtain their human hair?
I don't know, dear. The morgue, I won't be surprised.
Bedlam! They get their hair from the lunatics at Bedlam.
Then you think?
Fogg's Asylum? Why not? For the right amount, they'll sell you the hair off any madman's head.
And the scalp to go with it, too, if requested. Excuse me, gentlemen, I'm out.
We will offer this, Mr. Fogg, the highest price for hair, the exact shade of Joanna's, which I trust you know.
Yes. Yellow?
Not exact enough. I must make you into a credible wig maker, and quickly. There's tawny, and there's gold and saffron, there's flaxen, and there's blonde. Now, repeat that. Repeat it?
Yes, Mr. Todd.
Well?
There's tawny, and there's gold and saffron, there's flaxen, and there's blonde.
Good. There's coarse and fine, there's straight and curly, there's gray, there's white, there's ash, there's pearly, there's green, there's yellow, there's black, there's tawny, and blonde.
Sweeney waited too long before, but never again he swore.
Fortune arrived, Sweeney attacked. Sweeney was ready and Sweeney sprang.
Sweeney's problems went up in smoke, all resulted in a single stroke.
Sweeney was sharp, Sweeney was burning. Sweeney began the engine turning. Sweeney, 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 Sweeney,
The flaxen's
yes,
cheaper.
I know, it's cheaper, not rarer.
Here's money, and here is the pistol. For kill, if you must. Kill.
I'll kill a dozen jailers if need be to set her free.
But Anthony, listen to me. When you have rescued her, bring her here. I will guard her while you hire the chaise for Plymouth.
We'll both be with you before the evening is out. Thank you, Mr. Todd. Friend?
Ah, off with you.
most honourable Judge Turpin.
Most honourable Judge Turpin.
Most honourable.
Honourable.
I venture thus to write you this. Urgent.
Note to warn you that the hot-blooded
young
sailor
has abducted your ward, Johanna.
Johanna.
Johanna. The institution where you
so wisely
confined her.
But hoping to earn your favor, I have persuaded the boy to lodge her here tonight at my tonsorial parlor.
In Fleet Street. If you want her again in your arms, hurry after the night falls.
She will be waiting.
Humble servant, Sweeney
this letter to Judge Turpin. It's urgent.
Sweet Polly Plunkett, lying in the grass, flew down the city road crying.
So that sign up, Mum?
Oh, that's my boy. Look, dear, I've knitted a lovely muffler. Guess who it's for?
God, for me?
Wouldn't you like to know?
Oh, you're so good to me, Mum. Well, sometimes when I think of what it was like with Signor Pirelli, well, seems like the good Lord sent you for me.
Oh, just my Walmart, dear. Room enough there for all God's creatures.
You know, Mum, well, there's nothing I wouldn't do for you. If there was a monster or an ogre or anything bad like that what was after you, well, I'd rip it apart with my bare fists, I would.
Oh, what a sweet child it is.
Or even if it was just a man.
A man, dear?
Well, what a man what was bad, and what might be luring you all unbeknownst into his evil deeds, like.
But what is this? What are you talking about?
Nothing's gonna harm you, not while I'm around.
Of course not, dear. Why should it?
Nothing's gonna harm you, no, Mum, not while I'm around.
What do you mean, a man?
Demons are prowling everywhere nowadays. I'll send them howling, I don't care, I got ways.
Oh, you do. Oh, what a sweet, affectionate child it is.
No one's gonna hurt you, no one's gonna dare.
I know what Toby deserves.
Others can desert you, not to worry, whistle, I'll be there.
Here, have a nice bonbon.
Demons will charm you with a smile for a while. But in time, nothing can harm you, not while I'm around.
Now, Toby, dear, what is this foolishness? What are you talking about?
Well, it's little things that I've been thinking and wondering about. Well, it's him you've seen, Mr. Todd. I know you fancy him, but men ain't like women. They ain't what you can trust, as I've lived and learned. Not to worry, not to worry. I may not be smart, but I ain't dumb. I can do it, put me to it. Show me something I can overcome. Not to worry, Mum. Being close and being clever ain't like being true. I don't need to, I won't never hide a thing from you. Like so.
Now, Toby, dear, ain't we had enough of this foolish chatter? Hey, let's just sit nice and quiet for a bit. Yeah, have a nice bonbon.
That's in your Pirelli's purse.
What? What was that, dear?
Well, that proves what I've been thinking. That's his purse.
Silly boy. Oh, that's just a little something Mr. T gave me for my birthday.
Wait, now, Mr. Todd gave it to you well, and how did he get it? How did he get it?
Bought it, dear. In a pawn shop, dear. Come on now. Nothing's gonna harm you. Not while I'm around. Nothing's gonna harm you, darling. Not while I'm around.
But you don't understand. Was in it too, or free? When the governor giving up his purse with 2 quid, not for a minute, don't you say? But it was in Mr. Todd's parlour that the governor disappeared.
Oh. Boys and their fancies, whatever will we think of next? Here, dear, you come and sit here by your own Nelly like a good quiet boy. And look at your lovely muffler. How warm it's going to keep you as the days draw. Don't be coming on you.
Demons who charm you with a smile for a while, but in time nothing's gonna harm you. Not while I'm around.
You know, dear, it's the strangest thing you come into chat with me right now of all moments, because as I was sitting here with my needles, I was thinking, oh, what a good boy Toby is. He's so affectionate, so hard-working. And then I thought, well, you know how you've often fancied coming with me into the bakehouse to help bake the pies?
Why, yes, Mum, indeed, Mum, yes.
Yes, well, how about it then, eh?
What do you mean it? Well, I can help make him and bake him.
No time like the present, is there? There.
God, it's quite a stink, isn't it?
Oh, no, no, don't go down there, dear. Them steps lead down to the old cellars and the whiffs come up. God knows what's down there, so mouldy and dark. And there's always a couple of rats gone home to Jesus. Now, the bake ovens is here.
Hey, were they big enough, isn't they?
Hardly big enough to bake all the pies we sell. 10 dozen at a time. Now, always be sure to close the door properly like this. Now, here's the grinder. You see, you pop meat in, you grind it, and it comes out here. And you know the secret? The secret what makes the pie so sweet and tender. 3 times. You must put the meat through the grinder 3 times.
3 times, eh?
Mm. That's my boy. Smoothly. Smoothly. And as soon as a new batch of meat comes in, we'll put you to work.
Oh, me making pies all on me own.
Mrs. Lovett.
Hey, where you going, Mum?
Back in a moment, dear.
Smoothly, does it?
Mrs. Lovett. Oh. What a beautiful harmonium. Sweet Polly Plunkett lay in the grass, turned her eyes heavenward sighing. I am a lass, who a lass, lass a lad, who a lass has a lass in Canterbury. Tis a row-dow-diddle-dow-day, tis a row-dow-diddle-dow-day.
Oh, Beadle Bamford.
Bamford. Oh. Now then, I didn't know you was a music lover and all.
Good afternoon, Mrs. Lovett. Oh. A fine instrument you've acquired.
Oh, yes, yes, my pride and joy.
Sweet Polly Plunkett, I saw her life pass, flow down the city road crying. I am a lass who a lass loves a lad, who a lass has a lass loves another lad, who once I had in Canterbury. Tis a row dow, diddle dow day, tis a row dow, diddle dow dee.
Oh, I must say, you did not sing that beautiful. Oh, thank you so much.
Well, ma'am, I hope you have a few moments, for I'm here today on official business.
Official?
That's it, ma'am. You see, there's been complaints.
Complaints?
About the stink from your chimney. They say at night it's something foul. Health regulations being my duty, I'm afraid I have to ask you to let me take a look.
At the bakehouse?
That's right, ma'am.
Well, it's locked, you see, and I don't have the key. Now, it's Mr. Todd upstairs. He's got the key and he's not here right now.
Oh. When will he be back?
Oh, I couldn't say, I'm sure.
Oh, look. One of Mother's favourites.
Oh!
If one bell rings in the tower to bray, ding dong, your true love will stay. Ding dong, one bell today in the tower to bray. Ding dong, dong. What was that?
Oh, that... That's just my boy, the lad who helps me with the pies.
But surely he's in the bakehouse, isn't he?
Oh, yes, yes. Oh, yes. Yes, yes. Well, you see, to be perfectly honest with you, he is a little bit simple in the head. And last week he ran off. We found him 2 days later, half-starved, down by the embankment, poor soul. So, ever since then, we locked him in for his own security.
Then we'll have to wait for Mr. Todd, won't we? But if two bells ring in the tower to bray, ding, since you're a fellow music lover, ma'am, why don't you raise your voice along with mine?
Oh, thanks ever so much, I'm sure.
A ding dong,
ding dong,
your true love will stray. Ding dong,
ding dong,
two bells today
in the tower to bray. A ding dong, a ding dong. Lovely song that was.
If three bells ring in the tower of prayer.
No, no. Oh, I'm so forgetful, you know. I'm so silly sometimes. Mr. Todd's gone down to Wapping. He won't be back for hours. Oh, he will be so sorry to have missed you. Why, only the other day he was saying, if the Beadle would just grace my tonsorial parlour, I would give him the daintiest shave and the most stylish haircut, all for nothing. So why don't you pop back some other time, eh? And take advantage of his offer.
That's real friendly of him. If four bells ring in
Look,
the tower...
Just how many bells are there?
12. A ding dong.
Ding dong.
Ding dong. The lovers must pray. Ding dong.
Ding dong.
Ding dong. Four bells today.
Good evening.
Oh, back already. Look, Mr. T, look who's here on some foolish complaint about the bakehouse or something. He wants the key, and I told him you'd got it. But he, Oh, yes. Well, there's no need to hurry, is there, sir? Why don't you pop upstairs with Mr. Todd and let him fix you up nice and pretty? Oh, yes, there'll be plenty of time for the bakehouse. later.
Well, tell me, Mr. Todd, do you pomade the hair? I dearly love a pomaded head.
Pomade! Oh, yes, of course. And a nice facial rub with bay rum to go with it. All for nothing.
Well, sir, I take that very kindly.
I am, sir, entirely at your disposal. Will you come this way?
Yes, no. Of course. Well, let's hope he can do it quietly. Just to be on the safe side, I'll provide a little musical send-off.
Sweet Polly Plunkett lay in the grass, turn your eyes heavenward, sighing.
A pie. As a rook. Oh, that ain't Mrs. Lovett's, eh? Oh, well, some old black care, probably. A fingernail. That's clumsy. Oh. Ah! Beadle! Mrs. Lovett! Mrs. Lovett! Mrs. Lovett? Mrs. Lovett, let me out! Let me out! The cellar. I'll hide in the cellar.
Sweet Polly Plunkett. Oh! Oh!
It's done.
Not yet, it's not. The boy, he's guessed.
Guess what?
About Pirelli. Since you weren't here, I locked him in the bakehouse. He's been yelling to wake the dead. We've got to look after him.
But the judge is coming. Oh. I've arranged it.
You worrying about the bloody judge at a time like this. Come on.
Sweeney's led to the entry's match.
A beadle arrived and a beadle dispatched
to satisfy the hungry god
of Sweeney Todd.
The demon barber of
Sweeney!
Street.
Sweeney! 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 Sweeney!
You do me honour, Mr. Fogg.
Oh, I agree. You know, it would be to our mutual interest to come to some arrangement regarding my poor children's hair.
Your children?
Oh, yes, sir. We're all one happy family here, sir. And all my patients are my children, to be corrected when they're naughty and rewarded with a little sweetie when they're good. But to our business. Hold this lamp. Now,
thank
yellow.
You.
Oh, here is a charming yellow. A little dull in tone, perhaps, but you can soon restore it to its natural gleam. Oh, dear, a fine texture for a man. And as you know, sir, there is always a discount on the hair of a male.
Mr. Fogg, this one over here has hair the shade I seek.
Oh, well, she needs so much correction, you know. She sings all day and all night, leaves the other inmates sleepless. Come, child, smile for the gentleman, and you shall have a sweetie.
No,
come
no.
Here. Come here.
No, no.
Now, sir,
Anthony.
Where shall I cut?
Anthony.
Johanna, come here.
What is this? Hey, what is this then?
Unhand her.
Why, you.
Stop, Mr. Fogg, or I will fire.
Fire? And I will stop.
Antony!
Come on, then. I cannot shoot!
Then give the gun to me!
Oh, yes.
Kiss me!
Joanna!
There! Oh! Running on the chimney street! Black rose station of the city on fire! City on fire! City on fire!
Toby,
where are you,
love? Toby, where are you,
love? Nothing's gonna harm
Toby.
You. Not while I'm around.
Toby.
Where are you hiding? Nothing's gonna harm you, darling.
Nothing to be afraid of, boy!
Wicked one, she'll deceive you with her fancy gowns and her fancy airs and her mischief, mischief, devil of war!
Where are you, Beadle, Beadle?
Back in a moment, for I trust him as I trust my right arm. Now, you wait for him here, and I'll return with a carriage in less than half an hour.
But they're after us still. What if they trace us here? Antony, please let me come with you.
No, there is no safety for you on the street.
But dressed in these sailor's clothes, who is to know it is I?
No, the risk is too great.
Look at me, miss, oh, look at me, please. Oh, favor me with your glance. Ah, miss, soon we'll be gone and sailing the seas and happily, happily wed in France. And we'll sail the world and see its wonders from the pearls of Spain.
We'll be back before those lips have time to lose that smile.
Dee da dee da dee.
father's at tea with the Swedish king. He'll bring you the moon on a silver string. Oh, oh. Quickly to sleep then, my Joe, my Jing. He'll bring you a shoe and a wedding ring. Sing here again, home again, come again, spring. He'll be coming soon now to kiss you, my Joe, my Jing. Bringing you the moon and a shoe and a wedding ring. He'll be coming here again, home again.
What are you doing here?
Evil is here, sir. The stink of evil from below, from her.
How dare
she? She's the devil's wife. Beware her, sir. Beware of her. She with no pity in her heart.
Out, I say.
Hey, don't I know you, mister?
Come! The judge! I have no time!
Below, sir, in the care of my neighbour, Mrs. Lovett.
Where is that young sailor?
Oh, thank heavens the young man did not molest her. Oh. And thank heavens, too, she has seen the error of her ways.
She has.
Oh, yes. Your lesson was well learned, sir. She speaks only of you longing for forgiveness.
And she shall have it. She'll be here soon, you say?
I think I hear her now.
Oh, excellent, my friend.
Is that her dainty footstep on the stair?
I hear nothing.
Yes, isn't that your shadow on the wall?
Where?
There! Primping, making herself even prettier than
even prettier,
if possible.
Oh, pretty women.
Pretty women, yes.
Quickly, sir, a splash of bay rum.
Sit, sir, sit.
Johanna, Johanna.
Pretty women.
Hurry, man.
Pretty women.
You're
are the one
today.
Pretty women.
What we do for pretty women. Women.
Blowing out
their candles.
Or coming out
their hair.
Even when they
leave. You and that is
they somehow can still
are there. You are there. Seldom it is one meets a fellow spirit
with fellow tastes in women, at least.
What was that?
Oh, sir, no doubt the years have changed me. But then, I suppose, the face of a barber, the face of a prisoner in the dock, is not particularly memorable.
Benjamin Barker!
Benjamin Barker!
Rest now, my friend. Rest now forever. Sleep now the untroubled sleep of the angels.
Toby! My razor! You! What are you doing here? Speak!
Oh, dear. Excuse me, sir. I saw the barber's sign, so thinking to ask for a shave, I...
When? Where did you come in?
Oh, sir, I beg of you. Whatever I have seen, no man shall ever know. I swear it.
A shave,
oh, sir, please,
eh?
Sir.
At your service, sir.
But, sir!
And whatever you may have seen, your cheeks are still as much in need of the razor as before. Sit, sir! Sit!
No! No! No!
Anthony! Come back!
Die! Die!
Roses in for Christmas.
demons of hell come to torment me.
Quick, to the oven.
Why do you scream? Does the judge still live?
No, he was clutching, holding onto my skirt, but now he's finished.
Leave them to me.
No.
Open the oven doors.
No.
Open the doors, I say.
No, don't touch her.
What's the matter with you? It's only some meddling old beggar who... From the first moment that I walked into your shop, you knew my Lucy lived.
I was only thinking of you.
Lucy.
Oh, your Lucy. A crazy hag picking up rotten spuds and bones out the gutter. Would you have wanted to know that's what became of her?
You lied to me.
No, no, not lied at all. No one ever lied. Said she took the poison. She did never say that she died. Poor thing. She knew when it had the wind.
Lovett, you're a bloody wonder, eminently practical and yet appropriate as always. As you've said repeatedly, there's little point in dwelling on the past. No, come here, my love.
I didn't swear a fault was only for the quest.
Don't fear, my love. What's dead is dead. The history of the world, my pet.
Oh, Mr. Todd, leave it to me.
Is learn forgiveness and try to forget.
By the same, Mr. Todd, we've become the cozy you and me, Mr. T, when there's no one knows.
And life is for the alive, my dear. So let's keep living it. Just keep living it. Living, living it. A barber and his wife, and she was beautiful. A foolish barber and his wife, she was his reason and his life, and she was beautiful, and she was virtuous. And
a pie to delight my eye, and I will scythe the crust behind.
Ah, Lucy.
Mr. Todd. It's the old woman. You harmed her too, have you? Well, you shouldn't, you know. Well, you shouldn't harm nobody! Duggan, watch me grind my corn. Pat him and prick him and mark him with B. And put him in the oven for baby and me.
Ah!
Ah.
Mr. Todd!
You will pardon me, gentlemen, but you may not enter here. Now, my mistress, well, she don't let no one enter here. For you see, sirs, there's work to be done. So much work. Well, 3 times, this is a secret. 3 times through for them to be tender and juicy. 3 times through the grinder. Smoothly. Smoothly.
Attend the tale of Sweeney Todd. His skin was pale and his eye was odd.
He shaved the faces of gentlemen who never thereafter were heard of again.
He trod the path that few have trod.
Did Sweeney Todd,
the demon barber of Fleet Street.
He kept a shop in London town, a fancy client and good renown.
And what if none of their souls were saved? They went to their maker impeccably shaved.
By Sweeney Todd,
the demon barber of Fleet Street.
Swing your razor wide, Sweeney, hold it to the skies. Freely flows the blood of those who mummized.
His needs are few, his room is bare. He uses his fancy chair. The more he bleeds, the more he lives. He never forgets and he never forgives. Perhaps today you gave a nod to Sweeney Todd, the demon barber of Fleet Street.
Sweeney wishes the world away. Sweeney's weeping for yesterday. Hugging the blaze, breaking the gears, hearing the music that nobody hears. Sweeney wishes the world.
Attend the tale of Sweeney Todd.
Attend the tale of Sweeney Todd.
He served a dog and a hungry god.
He served a dog and a hungry god.
To seek revenge may lead to hell.
But everyone does it if seldom as well.
As Sweeney.
As Sweeney Todd.
Thank you.